Hi there, and welcome to Central Texas Gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. You know, we can't control the weather, but we can take charge of its impact on our gardens. Today, sustainable designer Adams Kirkpatrick illustrates how simple and natural techniques make a difference. On tour, let's visit a gardener who's done just that.
Beyond a curbside screen against traffic and noise, you can find Gail and Don Clowe hanging out on their front yard treehouse deck. Many nights, the neighbors follow the front path to enjoy the balcony view to Dawn's garden, uninterrupted by passing cars.
It is so peaceful, and you know, he's created just such a glorious environment, and I love we have a little cove in the Japanese area where our granddaughter loves to go, and she calls it her secret garden. And then in the waterfall area in the southwestern garden, two of my grandchildren love to go over and see the waterfall. And there's the first thing that they want to do when they come. So it's, you know, and it's just a delightful environment for adults and for children.
The front yard wasn't always like this.
We bought this in, 1980? Yeah, 1980. The pittosporums were here, but very low, but pretty plain Jane type of just standard lawn.
And this was like ivy, wasn't it?
Yeah.
One plant at a time, Dawn exchanged its cookie cutter facade for one that documents significant life impressions.
I'm not a landscaper. I'm basically a plant collector. And so what I built are these little rooms, and I try to display the plants in a good way, rather than just landscaping.
One room is the deck at the front door.
There was a smaller deck here, actually only about 3 feet wide. And finally, happily, it collapsed. And so we had to do something and built this one quite bigger. And it kind of just altered the whole viewing area.
As an extended living room, it alters their view from inside. Outside, as an upper story perch, its view connects two garden styles. One side was influenced by Dawn's time in Japan. He even saw how to give the old pittosporums a new profile.
The pittosporum actually came all the way over where you couldn't walk, and so I started cutting them back, and they had an interesting shape, and you could shape them like give it Japanese style.
Foremost, Dawn is a plant collector who designs for what works well in each spot, rather than a notion of what should be there.
I found some bromeliads. Big specimen type bromeliad is very cheap. And that doesn't really fit into a Japanese garden, but that particular environment, that little niche over there by the waterfall, is perfect for these plants. And so if you're a collector rather than a landscaper, you let that kind of be your guide.
The front sidewalk transitions the garden from Japanese to the southwest.
I don't, you know, see any reason why you can't have a southwestern garden and a Japanese garden, too. I like the Santa Fe area, the Taos area, so I got real interested. If I had my druthers, I'd have kind of a Santa Fe, southwestern Mexican garden. The southwestern garden is based upon a book called Stones for a Barrow, which has to do with a tradition where when someone has died, to put a stone in remembrance. And so the garden is made up of stones from our neighbor of 20 years who also had a house in Colorado where we would go, and I would collect stones. And there's also stones from a place in New Mexico that we went years and years ago. I went nuts one summer and picked up all these stones. I had two flats on the way home. We had so many stones. So anyway, I got the idea of using these stones as a remembrance to these people. And so all these stones are placed there, and so it forces us to enforce us, but we think about them. There's now a stone from my father and mother's grave, her father's grave, grandparents. So it's, you know, a special place. It's a personal garden. And along that line, when we first moved to San Antonio years ago, a lot of people in town would have little niches in their front yard, a little saint to a relative. And that, you know, is the, they got younger, they it's kind of gone away. You don't see that much of it anymore. And so the Southwestern garden is kind of a throwback to that. And like I say, it's just that a garden is not just be viewed by somebody, but a personal thing, and reflects how you feel.
The front yard isn't huge, but Don's paths give it spatial dimension.
We hike a lot, and so I've always liked paths where it's just the only difference between it and the flowers or the trees is that it's worn down by feet. So, and particularly desert paths are that way. So the Southwestern and all the paths around here really are all very informal. The only outlining of them are old pieces of limb I'll drag up and stick there, so that none of it has a formal look, but reminds me of the paths and the woods that you hike.
At the same time, Don avoids a jumbled look.
What I like is to have a plant that is displayed well.
He carries that philosophy to the backyard, where he created an entirely different atmosphere.
We've done a lot of entertaining in our, you know, our yard and our house, and when people see what he's done, they say, "Gail, he is an artist." And I go, "Yes, that's his art form. You know, plants are his art form."
When he's not in the garden, Don is in his greenhouses, propagating plants or supervising cold tender ones over winter.
I used to be an assistant DA, and I put people in prison that had addictions like mine. Thank goodness mine is legal. Because you just get into plants and it's just fun. It's just a great joy that it brings to you.
Oh, it's always nice to see a garden that has so many different stories to tell. That one certainly did. Thanks for sharing your garden with us. Right now we're going to be talking about creating plant communities or plant guilds that will sustain themselves by the relationships that are created between them. I'm really fascinated by this, and I think you will be too. I'm joined by Adams Kirkpatrick from Sunflower Design, and it's great to have you back on the program.
Thanks for having me.
This is, I think, a wonderful concept, and for people who are struggling for strategies, you know, with the difficulties we're facing with climate and weather and all, drought, et cetera, right now, what we're going to be talking about to me makes a lot of sense in terms of offering an overarching strategy for people.
Absolutely. It's all about retaining water in the soil and protecting the soil, shading the soil. So we have the strategy of planting 7 different layers, from the top canopy trees to mill-sized trees and small understory trees, as well as small, medium, and large shrubs. And then ground cover, so that by the time the sun tries to make its way to the ground, it's just been blocked 100 different times.
Right.
And the way this grows in, over time, your ground cover starts to recede and the larger things start to shade it out.
Right.
But initially, it's bringing nitrogen into the soil, and it's providing a thicker and thicker, healthy layer of soil or duff. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, what one of the attributes of these gardens is that a typical landscape in a typical rain will lose about 80% of the water from evaporation, et cetera.
Sure. Runoff,
et cetera. And these gardens can retain as much as 100% of even some very heavy rains because it's basically planting a huge sponge.
I love the concept, and I want to take people through those 7 layers. You know, because what we're really doing is mimicking forest here.
Yes.
And to me, which is a lovely thing, I come from the East. That's the natural climb that, I, you know, that it speaks to my heart. But we are able to do it right here in Central Texas.
Absolutely. And so starting at the bottom, you plant a layer of nitrogen-fixing leguminous ground cover like mountain pea.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go in with various layers. They could all be planted in 1 gallon plants. They can all be planted very small, very affordably.
Mm-hmm.
And then you put in all of your great soil amendments, use some mushroom composts, et cetera, to jumpstart the land. And then everything that falls, all the leaves that fall, start to continually build that soil
right.
over time so that they're all feeding each other. They're all improving the soil constantly.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, I've got a picture of a design that I did where the plants actually are abnormally large and they take a lot less water,
mm-hmm.
which is great because we have obviously serious water issues in
sure.
Central Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And the more water we can retain in the soil, I believe we can change climate.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a huge statement to make, and it will take an enormous amount of cooperation.
Mm-hmm.
But on a micro scale, I've seen that happen with my designs. The one picture with the philodendron in it, if you stand at the top of that hill on 100 degree days, it's 100 degrees. If you stand at the bottom of the hill, you feel a cool breeze coming down that hillside.
Mm-hmm.
Because that soil is so cool and the water is just holding on and it's locked into the soil and the soil just keeps getting healthier year after year. All of these plants really work well together in the guild concept.
Mm-hmm. And that's something I want to spend a little bit of time talking about because we can call it a plant guild, which is a great concept, or a plant community,
mm-hmm.
but they work together. To create a sustainable environment for themselves, if you bring the right participants to the party, so to speak, right?
Yeah, and the same thing is true of soil. You know, when you build soil, you want to make sure you have compost, air, water, mushroom matter, bacteria, microbes, all of the different things that work together, and this promotes that, as well as the guilds. One of the concepts of the guilds is that the fungal mat, the fungus that surrounds roots, like mycorrhizal fungi that people put in when they first plant trees and some plants, that is the intelligence of the whole system. It transfers nutrients as needed to all of these different plants. And so these plants that are in the same guild share the same fungal mat.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some very interesting ideas that are surrounding that, one of which is a little bit off base, but you know, the China berry that is a dreaded invasive plant here has actually, I've witnessed it stopping, I've seen oak wilt go up to a China berry tree and a grove of them and not go past. And there's some thought and research being done on that it may be a neem oil equivalent. Mm. So it may have some sort of antiseptic capacity, which it's a very dangerous tree to plant because it can do a lot of damage.
Yeah, I'm busily trying to eradicate
Absolutely.
Them everywhere, right? Yeah.
But, you know, nature surprises us. It may be that it actually has a benefit on some level as well. And I don't recommend them by any means because it's dangerous. If the berries get out, then they can take over greenbelt space. But there are some interesting relationships that happen with the fungal mat and the natural sort of health of a system.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I love the idea of seeing big change happen, climate change even happening, due to the micro actions.
Right.
And I know that you're involved with the Center for Maximum Building Potentials now, and those are folks who've been pioneering this kind of thought for a long time.
Right.
But I'm thinking, okay, let's take your typical suburban household.
Mm-hmm.
With a lawn, maybe a strip of shrubs, you know, planted up tight around the house.
Mm-hmm.
How do folks begin to convert that kind of landscape and start looking to this idea of the seven layers, kind of mimicking the forest?
So there's a natural spacing that occurs over hundreds of years in a forest. We're planting a forest, seeding a forest, if you will, for the concept that it's not going to be done in 10 or 5 or even 50 years. So you create spacing where the tallest trees are, say, about 35 or 40 feet apart. And I'm going to post something on my website that diagrams the spacing. And then within that, you start to step down so that eventually when these tall trees grow up, their canopies are touching but not clashing, which can be a problem.
Yeah.
But you survey your property, see what you have, and fill in the gaps. It's very simple. I mean, and then of course adding lots and lots of good mulch and rough mulch and compost and compost tea can jumpstart the landscape as well. But you know, just basically looking at what you have and designing around that.
And you mentioned, you said bringing in all this good stuff for the soil, but also maintaining what you keep in the soil.
Yes.
I mean, you know, the leaves coming off the trees stay on your property. You don't bag them up and throw them away.
That's right. They're a resource. We have this idea that we're kind of giving away the gold and silver. And I'm very much a proponent of keeping it on site. And, you know, there come into play a lot of practical issues, like what are we going to do about drainage and what are we going to do about paths and, you know, things overgrow. So how do you tend a garden like this? And they're very self-reliant. So they sort of tend themselves. As one starts to shade out the other, then branches fall off and the system sort of takes care of itself.
They begin to interlock.
It definitely does so. And that said, you know, you still can come up with systems of berms and swales and diversion so that you're, you know, you sort of plan for areas to for all of the water to go in. You can put in a sink like a foot or two deep and then fill it with gravel, wrap the gravel and have all the drainage in your backyard go into that, and then plant your forest, seven layer food forest or however you want to do that, food or production or not, and then all of that drainage will go in there, and then all the roots will go in and they'll just absorb out enormous amounts of water.
Right.
So like a live oak, a mature live oak in a flash flood can take up to 40,000 plus gallons of water in an hour. Just suck it out of the ground instantly.
In this past year, they would have been very happy to do that.
Absolutely, and it becomes a place for you to store water. These trees are all storing massive amounts of water.
I want to spend more time talking about drainage and keeping the water on the property, because there's some effective low-scale interventions that people can do here. You mentioned the drain, which is a very simple thing to do. It's basically dig a pit, you know, wrap it. You can use some kind of cage device, actually, if you want to support the wrap, and then you can backfill with gravel.
Yes.
And it's amazing how much water will gather in that area. And you can also use berms, correct? What are some of the other things?
Well, there are specific products. GeoGrowers has Berm Builder, and that is an amazing absorptive material that will absorb enormous amounts of water in a rain. Also, you know, when you talk about berms and swales, a lot of people see in their minds a ranch or a 4-foot swale or berm over 10 feet. And you don't have to be that large scale. And what works in backyards is the concept of microberms. And you can place, you know, a 6-inch tall, 8-inch wide berm, very human scale, easy for people to get out there with their kids and do. And if it fails, guess what? It's only 6 inches tall. You can come back with your shovel or your foot and fix it. So these are strategies that work, and also the idea of one big swale over a 10-foot space has only this much surface area to catch water.
Yeah.
But if you ripple along contour, a lot of different berms and swales, then your surface area dramatically increases, and you can bring in a lot more water.
Yeah.
So I've had small areas, very small, no bigger than this set, where I've done these types of techniques, and even in the heaviest of rains, the water just sort of disappears.
Yeah,
you can create these rock pits, or you can do leaf pits. You can do all sorts of different things.
And when you create these spongy grounds, you're going to get mushrooms, and people shouldn't freak out about that.
No, not at all.
Right?
They're good. Mushrooms are the backbone of all processes that happen in the landscape. They transfer. They choose which plant needs what, and they allow for the transfer of all nutrients into all plants. They are just literally the backbone of all of our agricultural industry, all of our landscape industry. If you don't have a fungal mat that's healthy and in place, the plants can't take up nutrients.
Oh, okay.
So it's extraordinarily important to have that.
All right. Well, lots of great advice here, and I really want to suggest that people visit your website at sunflowerdesign.net.
Yes.
They can learn a lot more about this concept. And Adams, it's always a fun visiting with you. I think this is very exciting, simple to grasp, and a very reproducible kind of concept.
Absolutely.
For our folks out there. So thank you.
Thank you.
This week, our friend Daphne is on break for AgriLife Extension Travel. Right now, let's check in with another of our good friends, John Dromgoole, for Backyard Basics.
Hello, gardening friends. Welcome to Backyard Basics. Well, we've been in a lot of trouble here when it comes to gardening, haven't we? Lack of water, extreme heat, really stressful for the plants. But there are things out there that would be very helpful. This climate change has made a big difference in how we garden. And also coming along are some new products. New to us, but ancient, millions of years old. And so this is something, it is a fungus. It's called Mycorrhizal, and myco means fungal, and rhiza means the roots. So this is a fungal organism that lives on the root system. And what it does is it brings nutrients back to the plant, and the plant gives nutrients back to the fungus. And the fungus goes way out into the rhizosphere, just opening it up dramatically. This is really important. Nursery plants don't have that. You'd see the fungal organism on there if they were here. And this is really root bound, but the organism would be white. It would be all over this. And from here, it would extend off into the ground. Now you can take some mycorrhiza and put it on here, trees, shrubs, just about anything. Matter of fact, 95% of the world's plants have mycorrhiza. So it's important that we have it here too. Because of this climate change, the soil is drier and the plants are stressed, and this mycorrhiza helps with that. It goes way off in the distance, brings those nutrients back, but better than that, it brings water back to the plant also. It mines the soil. Carbon is sequestered by these plants, and so, these organisms. So it has a tremendous amount of benefits. If you buy a plant or you transplant something, it's a great opportunity to put that mycorrhiza on there. It'll increase the growth of that plant, more flowers on the plant. It'll just make it much more vigorous than you ever saw by adding this mycorrhiza. That's the only name it has. I keep repeating it because when you walk into a nursery, that's the only thing that you'd be asking for is mycorrhiza. And it is widely available. It's becoming more available because of those things that I mentioned. Stress, the lack of water. This will improve the amount of water that the plant takes in. You don't have to water so much. The plant will find it down in the soil with the mycorrhiza. So this is a tremendous little product. You should put it on anything. I mentioned transplants, new nursery plants. Put it on there when you get the chance. Put it on the root system on the outside. If you've planted a garden, you can also find it in a soluble form. This little one right here is soluble. So this is going to be a good way to go out and drench the plants and see the difference. We're in a lot of trouble when it comes to gardening. It's so hot, it's so dry, and so stressful for the plants. And you can relieve all of that by using this mycorrhiza. Texas A&M did a lot of research on this for 25 years, and they really think it's a neat product. The rest of the country has done a lot of research too, and they've all collectively proven that this will enhance the growth of the plants out there. Take the stress off of the plants. This is one of the best things besides a nice mulch to get these plants off to a very, very good start. So whether it's a 4-inch plant or a 25-gallon or bigger, it doesn't make any difference. Placing some mycorrhiza on there will make all the difference in the world, will make the plants much hardier than you ever imagined, and the ability to bring back nutrients and water is part of what the mycorrhiza enhances. So for Backyard Basics, I'm John Dromgoole. I'll see you next time.
Visit klru.org/ctg to watch online, find out more, and visit our blog. Next week, check out why good plants go wrong. Until then, I'll see you in the garden.
To learn about today's program, watch online, and follow CTG's blog, check out klru.org/CTG.